Hi, it's Dan here once again, down in my basement. I have two absolutely superb basses to look at today. First of all, we're going to be looking at the Dingwall Combustion 4-string. And over on my right here, also from the Combustion series, the NG2 4-string. More on that in just a moment. We'll come back to that one. Let's hear this bass first. So, up at the headstock end as usual, and we'll work down so you can see the instrument in detail. We have the now famous Dingwall logo at the top, very nice indeed. And we have four licensed hipshot tuners. Let's flip the bass over, have a quick look at those. Over. There we go, open gear type, ultra lightweight. And we have a five-piece maple neck. Whilst we're here, let's slide on down, right down to the back of the body. It's a bolt-on bass, and this particular model features a natural finish over a swamp ash body. Okay, whilst I'm also here, we've got the normal control panel, but I want to show you this. Zooming onto electronics here, I like this a lot. Hopefully you can see that. It's a magnetic lid for the batteries. So no more losing screws or breaking those little rubbish plastic clip-on doors and things. Pop that off, change your batteries. Incidentally, you'll see in there 29 volts. This is an 18 volt circuit, but we'll talk about that in a minute, okay? Look at this, lovely sculpting away on the back of the body. Nice cutaway for getting up to the high frets as well. And it's a really eye-catching shape of the Dingwall series bodies as well. Okay, let's zoom over and finish off on the neck, and then we will move on down. Okay, here we go. So we have our headstock coming down. We have bone nut. And of course, you're going to notice that something is a little amiss as we look at the fretboard. This has been called all sorts of things, including wonky frets. So these basses feature the Novax fan fret system. Now, I've covered some Dingwall basses before in the magazine, and I've put some written information about the Novax fan fret system. So I will definitely point you back towards those reviews in my write-up with some more details about how the fan fret system works. So I don't want to cover that again, but I just want to mention that you'll notice that the frets fan out down the guitar neck. And you'll notice that the nut is at this angle and the bridge is at this angle. Now, essentially what this means is the low strings have a much longer scale length than the high strings. Certainly on the 5-string and 6-string models, it's really, really obvious. I've seen online a few people saying it must be like this because your fingers fan out. Not the case, although I'm sure it's very, very comfortable from that point of view. The idea is the same as actually looking inside a grand piano. The longer strings are for the lower notes, and as you come up, the shorter strings look after the higher notes. The speaking length of the string allows a lower tuning to have a lot more clarity and a bit more punch to the note. So the idea is the same for these basses. Do I think it works? Yes, I do, actually. I love the balance between the strings. It actually feels really, really comfortable to play. And it might look very, very daunting when you first look at this and say, it must be really difficult to play. Do you know what? I'll put money on this. You'll play this and you'll feel comfortable very, very quickly. Even though it looks like there's some big stretches down here, good hand position, you'll be fine. Trust me, it is very, very easy to play. Okay, so these frets, these are banjo-sized frets. So not only are they at an angle, they're also smaller than your standard jumbo frets that you'd find on a normal bass guitar. For me, I think it's really, really comfortable. I like being close to the neck. And it's certainly, I've not found any reason to complain. It's not stopping me from doing anything. Those are very tidily fitted, expertly fitted to in this case, a rosewood fretboard, and I'm running my finger up and down the side, and smooth, really nicely finished off. Brilliant stuff. Little white markers for the fret positions, and then if I just roll the bass forward very, very quickly, there's also dot markers on the top as well, like that. Coming up straight across to the body then, I talked about this cutaway. No problem with getting right up to the very, very high frets. So that'll upset your guitarist, you know, north of the border, as they say. So we can get right up to the top frets and play some really cool lead melodies or whatever it might be. I like that too. On to 3-ply pick guard, black, white, black. Gives us a nice little pinstripe around the top there as well. I like that. Really super. Okay, there we go. And I think that really goes with the natural body. Dingwall's own FD3N pickups. These are neodymium and have a lot of punch to them. You can make them aggressive quite quickly, but they will smooth out using the onboard EQ. So that's also a very nice touch. Down to the back, we have monorail bridge pieces with quick releases, so you can pop a string in and get a string change nice and quickly. Incidentally, these are strung EADG, but because we have the longer scale length, they'll take to BEAD tuning very well indeed. So you can get them set up for that and just pop on a set of heavier gauge strings. And actually, you probably drop down to like a drop A tuning and they'd still take it really well because you've got a 36¼-inch scale length for this string, going over to 34-inch for what's currently the G, but that'd be a D if you're going down a string, if you see what I'm saying. Moving around then, electronics, very, very nice indeed. On this particular bass, we have a 3-band EMG circuit, the BT07, treble, middle and bass, boost and cut, and a bypass switch as well, so you can actually switch the instrument completely to bypass, to passive mode as well. Master volume control, and then a selector switch rather than a pan control. It means that we can get some more modes on here than rather just panning from one pickup to another. We're going to start with the switch all the way around, so we've got just the neck pickup on its own. I'll do a bit of pick work, a little bit of fingerstyle work, and you'll hear each of the selections in turn. Here we go then. Just the front pickup on its own then. Okay, the next position round is both of these pickups in series. So you're gonna get a big volume boost, definitely extra punch in the mids as well. Okay, let's have a listen to this one then. Here we go. Next position round, we've actually got both pickups in parallel, so a softer sound with more top end sparkle. Here we go. Mm-hmm. Lovely. And then finally, round to the last position. It's just going to be the bridge pickup on its own. Here we go. A really nice clear sound there. I could see that being ideal for solo work or sticking in a bit of distortion and making things a bit aggressive. Very, very nice indeed. I love the series setting. It's a lot louder, it's got a lot more boost to it, and in conjunction with the EQ, it just sounds really, really fat, so I like that a lot. On the subject of the EQ, as I said, it's just bass, middle and treble, boost and cut, and we have the passive switch in here. Now at the moment I've got a little bit of bass boost, a tiny bit of mid cut, and a little bit of treble boost, so top and bottom with the middle scooped out. Let's have a little listen to the bass in the series mode very, very quickly. I'm going to switch it to passive just to get an idea of what the differences are. Okay, here we go. Very, very usable sound as well. Lots of mid, lots of almost like wood character to it as well. So you could actually switch between the two modes and not feel that you're losing out too much. Obviously with lots of boost on the EQ, all three bands, then you are going to notice a level difference. That's going to happen on any instrument at all. So just watch your settings on that. Okay, so rounding up this particular instrument, weighing in at just under 4 kilos, very, very beautifully made. These are manufactured in China, but incidentally they are moved, sent over to Canada for their final setup and fret dress. So you're getting all the benefits of the workshop in Canada for Dingwall, with not necessarily the premium price bracket of some of the top spec models. So this makes this a lot more accessible. And actually, it's still a fantastic premium instrument in itself. I think so anyway. Don't take my word for it though. You've got to get out and try these out. They're definitely worth it.